Okay, so I'm excited for this video. I'm gonna basically do a play-by-play on this Barry Harris transcription that I posted last month. It's just fantastic playing from Barry, very, very inspiring, and there's so much to talk about. It borrows some elements from Bud Powell's solo recording of It Could Happen to You, but there's a lot of other things in here that are distinctly Barry. And there's a lot to talk about with the piano and then these devices that he uses. I have to say, originally my intention was not to transcribe this whole intro. I was just going to transcribe one chord, because there's one chord in the second A section that is so, I mean, it's kind of mind-blowing. And it's also a great example of something that I talked about in an earlier Patreon video, the one called An Application of Barry Harris's Sixth Diminished Scale. And this chord, if you haven't seen that video, I'll put a link to it in the description, so please watch that. Because he uses elements of that device so well in this introduction. But I ended up just wanting to transcribe the whole thing because there's so much great stuff that I didn't want to ignore it. So yeah, if you haven't listened to this yet, please go to the video and watch the transcription as the recording is playing, because that's really the best education. But now I'll give you my 2 cents on the whole thing. So let's start at the top. The first chord. Now, if you never heard this before, and you didn't know what song he was about to play, this is a very ambiguous sound. Now we know it's F minor, you know, with the B flat in the melody. But he's not playing this. He's not playing this. He's not playing this. It's not that obvious. It actually sounds quite modern. And this is something to notice about Barry's playing in this whole introduction. He doesn't always use a lot of notes. He uses, in fact, a lot of very thin chords, sometimes just 2 notes, sometimes just 3 notes. But the way they're orchestrated sounds so full. And the fact that it's kind of few notes, not only does it resonate well in the piano, but it also adds a sort of mystery to the sound. So yeah, we have no idea what this is. Now, in the second measure, there's another thing I want to talk about. This chord, see how he releases the bottom note. This is a way that he plays chords often. We're going to see it throughout this transcription, and you're going to hear it throughout his playing. Instead of just playing a seventh like this, he might play this. So it's something that feels pleasant on the piano and also gives the chord more life. So just notice that, and I'm going to point it out as we go throughout the transcription, but this releasing of a bottom note happens a lot, and it's a cool sound on the piano. So going on. This introduction, he's just getting used to the piano. He's just playing freely through harmony in the key of E flat. And he comes up with, you know, these are pretty standard progressions, but he's really basking in the sound of all these chords. He's using the pedal. See, if I take these 3 notes, for example, and play them quite short, but use the pedal, then all of this harmony opens up, and you can just kind of bask in that sound. And I think every one of these chords, he's just enjoying the sound, enjoying the feedback he's getting from the piano. Oh, and now here's G over B. You know, traditionally when you have a chord in first inversion with the third in the root, you don't double the third in the rest of the chord. So he's not playing this. He's playing this. It's a subtle difference, but somehow the piano resonates better that way. So. Now check this out, about few notes. Here's a C7 chord. These three notes together make a sort of C-sharp minor triad. But it's very thin. He's not playing this. Or... not that there's anything wrong with that, but when you start with fewer notes, you can really let the piano speak. And also, later in the transcription, he's going to finally play thick chords. And the thick chords mean a lot more if, up until that point, you've only had thin chords. And choosing just a few notes in the chord that really speak well is actually more difficult than just throwing the whole kitchen sink in there. So, again, a great sound for C7, just three notes and the root. Moving along, F minor, just three notes. Let's listen to that. Did you hear that? The bottom vanished. So again, with this chord being played like this, it's just a nice effect. I notated it here in the transcription, but sometimes even when it's not notated, you can do that. Favor the top of a left-hand chord. Release the bottom. It just adds some life to the sound. Okay, so that was the intro. We got through the intro. Now here's the first A section. So, again, the bottom is lifted. It's not this. It just kind of makes the sound more alive. So, now he gets this 10th really nicely and really quietly all at once. I can't really get it, but good for him. Now, before we go on, one note. The chord changes that Barry uses as the bass changes for this tune. He goes G minor, B flat, E flat, A flat, major 7, D7, D flat. Maybe we're more used to G minor, A flat, G7, C7. But Barry's bass line is... it's very rich, but I wanted to point that out as that's not a reharm of the tune yet, because he's going to reharm those changes later. But for now, that's just his basic harmony. And those are the changes that Bud Powell kind of uses when he plays this tune. Maybe that's an older way of playing the tune. Regardless, it's very nice. Again, on this G minor, he releases the bottom. Now on this D7, he has this run. I've heard Barry say that a lot of his runs are 3 or 4 note arpeggios with just moved around the piano like that. A 4 note run could have been. So we'll see more of that coming up. It's a nice D7 whole tone kind of sound. Now, this whole tone run. Try that again. Now, that's kind of tricky, but actually, the way it lines up on the piano, you can use the fingerings 3-2-1, 3-2-1, 3-2-1. And it actually is pretty easy to play, as long as you know the starting points. And then it lines up nicely to go a half step down to C. Now, it's funny, if you started on this note, it's a little harder to play because your thumb ends up on a black note. It's not impossible, but starting here is just a little easier. And Barry does that on purpose. You can see he starts the triplets on the F. So it makes it play a little easier. And then a little run of up a sort of C7 altered scale. I don't know if he'd think of it that way, but... And then... This is a nice arpeggio. It's a four-note arpeggio like this. A wide arpeggio. Now, this sort of arpeggio is associated with Chopin. And I know that Barry loves Chopin. And actually, if you've seen this documentary that I highly recommend, it's called The Spirit of Bebop. It's all about Barry Harris. And in this documentary, there's footage of Barry having a lesson with a classical teacher, Sofia Rosoff. And they're actually working on this Chopin piece, Opus 10, number 1, the Etude in C, which is famous for this. And there's footage of Barry working on that with Sofia Rosoff. I'm mentioning that because you can see that arpeggio is similar. So that's something that a lot of pianists use. It's really an important moment in piano history. And yeah, Barry uses it here on a C7 sharp 5 chord. Okay, moving along. It's funny, like every measure, there's something I want to talk about.